If you need help uploading, I'm letting you know.
Okay.
All right, so, yeah, my presentation is on the economics of self-ownership. Let's see if it'll work. Hold on. By me. All right, so first, what is self-ownership? Does anyone have any ideas that they want to throw out there?
No,
that's what I'm here for. What is it?
Ability to protect yourself.
That could be. But, okay, here's the formal definition. Self-ownership is the concept of property in one's own person. So, considered like a moral or natural right for a person to, like, be the controller of their own body. So, each person can enjoy exclusive rights and control of themselves and doesn't owe anything, any service or product, any fruits of their labor to anyone else that he isn't voluntarily contracted to supply. So, people who consider themselves sovereign-minded individuals, they're usually people who believe in self-ownership. And they prefer sort of like a way of life that has like centralized administrative organizations who act as service to the individual. So voluntary groups that they can associate with rather than being told what to do with their own body. So types of people who are into self-ownership, you can just label classical liberals, individualists, ethical egoists, rights-based libertarians, objectivists, and individualist anarchists. So most of these people like, claim a right to self-ownership, whether it be through being protected by the government or just on its own. So one of the origins of self-ownership and its ideas comes from John Locke in his two treatises of government. He says every man has property in his own person. I don't know how to use it.
You just use the keyboard.
Yeah, the keyboard? Oh, cool. All right, so Locke said that the individual has the right to decide what would become of himself and what he would do, and as having a right to reap the benefits of what he did. So basically, the individual has all the power, you know, to get the benefits of anything that he does with his own body. So this leads us to discuss the ideas of private property and if it's found within oneself, which a lot of people believe in self-ownership. So a person who believes he or she is a sovereign individual usually asserts that private property, the right to private property external to the body. And they say if someone owns themselves, they own their actions. I haven't practiced. All right, so I guess. I guess any resources that are created from themselves, they consider that they own, such as their own labor and the fruits of their labor. So what does this have to do with economics? Right, so self-ownership and property are economical because of productive capabilities, like the act of labor and services provided with your body, and also the fruits of your labor. So basically the act of working or the act of doing something with your own body and things that come from that. And those things are economical because, you know, they can be sold, distributed, you know, be in a market. So then we get into government and how that has come to influence self-ownership, both directly and indirectly. So direct examples of market, so those are more indirect, like you're not producing them yourself, but items that you use for your person. So, direct ways that the government can influence self-ownership is through taxing and regulating business and employment. These are just two examples. So these things directly affect like the fruits of your labor or the services you can provide with your body. And indirectly, through regulating the market just generally, so then that decides what you can put in your own body and not allow your consumption of certain goods is one example. More specifically, government regulates labor by instituting labor laws, and then they have control over your self-ownership. So any laws that tell you, you know, how you can work or what you can do with your body, that's one good example. And also, government decides what you can or cannot put in your body, such as like the Food and Drug Administration, drug war type things. Self-ownership, sort of thing. Actually, can you guys think of any ways that government also can restrict self-ownership that aren't these two?
Marriage,
true. That's a good one, actually.
Yeah. Abortion.
Abortion, yeah, that's one of, like, the big contested ones that is, yeah, listed, like, in a whole other world.
Yeah.
I didn't get it. Suicide, yeah, that's a good one. That you can't decide to kill yourself for the rest of your life. So, I put up some Supreme Court cases as examples. Whether it be Filburn, basically this one was about a guy who grew wheat on his farm, and it was, even though like the wheat could be used for sustainability for himself, feed the cows, for instance, is still considered part of the market, so the government can regulate it, which means that this guy can't even, you know, use his body to, you know, farm goods and then give it to his own cows without government interfering. So that was a big blow to self-ownership and property. The efforts he put into his work were pretty much taken away from him. This one had to do with marijuana, and I believe, yeah, the woman in the case grew marijuana on her property and then was going to use it for herself, only for herself, medicinally, and then the government, you know, ended that one. And then this one just has to do with coal and the coal industry, and this was like one of the foot in the doors to like controlling, I think, wages and also like production, the amount of production, the amount of coal that could be taken out of the ground and stuff, and you know, all that, so that was a big one. So how are ways that you could retain your self-ownership if you believe in it, if you're one of those people that think self-ownership and still live in the government system that we have? First off, I hope that you can understand these ideas because a lot of times if you know what's going on and you're more of an enlightened person, you can sort of work on ways to get around conflicts with like the fact that you want to own yourself and your wealth and your property getting taken away from you. Agorism. This is sort of like the idea that I believe Deanna's going to talk about next week, but sort of about underground markets and working around the government to build up institutions that then compete with it. And this is a good way that you can still like have that business you might want, or do drugs or whatever you want, do whatever you want with your own body, and get around the government. And then a lot of people like working politically to fight some people are still fighting politically, and yeah, hopefully making some headway, changing things that way. So what could happen in government and society to promote more self-ownership? So I put up some examples of just like maybe possible things in the future that would allow more self-ownership, even with the government, so we can see what's going on. So, for instance, if government announced over the next 3 years that all state schools were privatized and there would be tax breaks for educational expenses and some vouchers. Congress approves a plan for completely privatizing Social Security. Tax breaks are given to encourage personal responsibility for savings. So that would mean that people would hopefully, you know, save their own money and their own wealth. So if the personal income tax was reduced to 24% and the lowest rate was reduced to 12%, basically just, you know, decreasing taxes would be a good thing. So this would be if the Supreme Court decided that one owned their own body, all abortion laws and drug laws are not unconstitutional. And wow, even schools would announce that effects of drugs help everyone to make. All right, so yeah, schools are told to, you know, reform their drug programs and stuff, so people can make better decisions rather than just right now. Again, that little thing, like some of these just like push that, you know, to educate people rather than, you know, tell them no, you can't do this, and then people make the decisions. Food and Drug Administration has gone private companies that determine product safety and quality ratings, all that, rather than a big government administration. And here's something that's just kind of out there, but that teachers promote more critical thinking courses and reasoning skills, probably because then people then, if they learn these things, then they can make better informed decisions. So I just have some things to think about. My presentation wasn't really as long and kind of sucks, but all right, so here's some questions we can go through as a group. So I guess we can just open it up to discussion, and we can do the first one. Do you feel that every human being is a sovereign individual, and does government overstep its bounds by its means?
Yeah, so I don't know if every human being is sovereign, because some human beings are just not. I mean, there are certain human beings who aren't handicapped or reliant on others that might limit their self-capacity. So in those instances, you know, maybe there's some